Welcome everybody to this webinar. In this first webinar, we are going to introduce a little bit of a new initiative, which is a global tax controversy group, which we are building with the support of Transfer Pricing Associates. So in a minute, I will give the floor to Steve Huibrechtsen to give a brief introduction. Afterwards, we will discuss, I will discuss a few pending cases I'm aware of, I'm involved in the Netherlands, where offshore structures were in place, and some of them, the offshore structure as such was a necessary structure, some of them it was a pure tax planning issue. And the idea of this webcast is to discuss some elements of the changes in international taxation, and afterwards go into some details about the cases, bring you up to date with the inspector's perspectives, and probably also with what I expect to be the outcome if these cases will arrive at a court. This first webinar is based on family-based businesses. It's not that we just focus on family-based businesses, because the discussions in which I'm going to do with you later on is purely based on three cases with family-based offices. And there are some specific items which are actually more present at family-based offices, like a shareholder which is acting all around the world, instead of at multinationals where functions are normally more divided between people. Okay, let's first start with an introduction of Steve. Steve, you are the initiator of this initiative. Perhaps you can bring us up to speed with why you do what you do, your intentions are, and how you see this this developing.
Yeah, thanks, Hans. Good afternoon, all of you. This is the first session, as Hans indicated, of a series of webinars we as TPA facilitate in the arena of BEPS controversy. We do believe that after BEPS, the world has become pretty flat, and what I mean with that is on one side, tax-sensitive data becomes very transparent, and as a consequence, a lot of stakeholders have a view or an interpretation on all that information coming their way. It's unprecedented in history, I think, at the level of the tax authorities, how much tax-sensitive data will land on their plate. And we had various technical sessions on that, but also discussions with multinationals. What is the tax inspector going to do with all of that information? So that's on one side. On the other side, what we see BEPS is doing, it has injected a lot of economic concepts in the way facts are being defined to create a taxable event. And these economic concepts include things like DEMPI, the Development, Enhancement, Maintenance, and Protection and Exploitation of Intangibles. Well, that's all great, but it's not really defined. Not even the guidelines give a good grip on one consistent interpretation what DEMPI really means. That means if you inject a lot of economic concepts into BEPS, and therefore in the interpretation of facts, and therefore in the size of the taxable income, the amount of taxable income, you land up in an arena of BEPS controversy. And that's why we believe for our clientele, we need a global BEPS controversy team, and these webinars are instrumental to also share that thinking with the marketplace. I think with that, we could move to the first slide. And the first slide basically is a simple version of how we looked at a tax, and particularly in the transfer pricing arena, before BEPS and after BEPS. Before BEPS, we said, okay, the economic reality, so how company runs its business can be the leading theme, but there's two other realities, namely the original reality, the legal reality on which paragraph 9 of the model treaty is based on. So you stick to your legal agreement unless proven otherwise, unless the conduct is significantly deviating from that. So that's the second reality. The third reality is a finance reality. So how do you book the books? So these three realities we like to be synchronized in a pre-BEP stage. So the question is a little bit, and that's the second triangle on this same page, what has changed after BEPS? Well, BEPS changed the ranking. And a lot of people are maybe not 100% aware of what that means. Well, it means that if conduct of parties and legal agreements so is the same, is fully synchronized, then still a contract has value. However, if the conduct deviates in the future from the contract, the third thing the tax inspector will do is put that contract in the shredder as being of null and void value and put it away as not relevant to construe or to assess facts on which taxation takes place. And that basically means that in the after BEPS arena, not only you need to synchronize economic, legal, and financial reality, as we already did before, but now you need to also look at governance models and the whole governance of a business model. One example could be a managing director of a say a chemical plant is working for a Swiss principal. However, the managing director does not report into anyone who's involved in production in Switzerland, but instead is reporting into the VP, the global VP of operations and manufacturing in the U.S. Well, that does trigger a deviation already in the governance model and the reporting around it. This information is easily extracted from the local transfer pricing files after BEPS. The governance model therefore needs to be synchronized with the operating model. And the operating model and the governance model need to be fairly reflected in the finance and tax reality as we already defined in the first triangle. So it becomes much more important for us tax people to be closer on the two concepts which are relevant for running a business. That's the governance model and that's the operating model, and all of these three realities need to be synchronized. If not, these are what I call the magic triangles. If not, you run into too many Bermuda triangles, and we all know what happens then. That's typically not very good. So this is a introduction of the theme of today, but also of the series of BEPS controversy webinars TPA is facilitating. And with that, I'd like to give the floor to Hans for the next slide.
Thanks, Dave. Well, as said, a little bit about the group. Tax controversy, as you'll discuss later, is a project being supported by TPA. We are working on a global network of independent people across firms. So we will have people in South Africa, US, India, name them where we work with, and we believe they are the best of the best. So it's just for you to know that we organized this one. Then I would like to commence with the technical parts. There are a few issues which you have to take into account, and apparently, to my opinion, in the Netherlands, the smaller companies have the biggest problems simply because the fact that functions are normally not split, but more or less focused on one specific person. But in order to deal with this, a few things about the changes, and it's too much to discuss all the changes, but a few things which I normally discuss when I discuss these with family-based companies. First of all, documentation. When I speak with family-based companies working in a national environment, they actually all seem to have documentation in place, being made by the tax advisor. Probably there's nothing wrong with documentation being made by the tax advisor, as long as the facts of the documentation are aligned with the economic reality, as Steve suggested before. And I have seen a few situations, and one of them I'm going to discuss later with you, where a company used a procurement company, organized procurement company in I believe it was Hong Kong, where also the functions, and of course with functions as a risk come along, have been described by the tax advisor, but where from the facts it was clear that this was a situation which is quite difficult to defend, simply because the suggested facts and the real facts were just not one. So from next year on, it's already in the current codes in the Netherlands and in many tax codes in the world, documentation will change. Many countries will use the momentum to, for smaller companies, so not the countries, the companies which have to report on the CBCR, but still they demand from companies to have better, deeper local files in place in order to make sure that the relation between the headquarters and the subsidiary in the country, specific country, is organized in a manner, is structured in a manner which is acceptable to the tax administration of that specific country. The VCA, as mentioned by Steve, is getting much more important. It's actually, if you would read, and not many people have read all the BEP sections, but if you would read Action 13, CBCR, you will see that OECD recommends something called a value chain analysis as part of documentation to all the companies. However, they forgot to actually define what a VCA is. And also from this perspective, I've had discussions with many tax advisors telling me, Hans, we already work for years at VCAs. And the problem is, the VCA is not a description where you actually motivate why you use, as an example again, a Dubai procurement company. The VCA is describing the economic reality as being perceived by the CEO and the CFO. And it's important not just for transfer pricing issues, but it's actually also very important for people doing tax litigation like myself. I always want to have a perfect clear fact perspective on the facts from the basis of the CEO and the CFO to make sure that when I'm in a dispute and I'm discussing a case before the court, that the court doesn't say, well, apparently the facts as you presume they are actually occur here are different from the tax inspector's perception. And where is the difference? You have to make sure that the facts are clear, and the tax inspector probably gets his information also from other tax tax administrations or from own fact finding. To give you one example, in one of the cases I'm running, the tax administration dived in all kinds of press releases from that company from the last 15 years. And this is, of course, a very effective way from the tax administration to deal with these kind of situations, because then you know whenever a company brings out a press release on something they're doing, that whatever they are doing, if it's in the press release, it must be in coherence with the facts. It must be simply the economic truth you want to use in any tax case. So that's one of the reasons why VCA is on the one hand not very new, but on the other hand, yes, I do believe it's new because it's the economic perspective and not the tax perspective or the legal perspective. Further on, you see a lot of discussions in a lot of states about all these changes and also discussions with taxpayers. I unfortunately also came across a few cases in my country, the Netherlands, where apparently the rules of the future are being applied on situations from the past. And I can tell you that this will happen in many, many other states. So in the end, it will be the court to decide, and probably the court will decide that they will compartmentalize new legislation and say, if the situation, well, that is assumed 2004, you have to apply the rules of 2004. And a too dynamic interpretation of tax conventions is being done by tax administrations nowadays seems to be over the top. Steve already mentioned VCA. China is not the inventor of the VCA, though it's the first state that actually demands a VCA if you want to get into an APA. But many, many more states like South Africa, Germany is demanding a VCA if you want to. The UK, by the way, if you want to stay out the deferred profits tax issues, then you probably need VCA in order to convince the tax administration. And that development is quite important. Other developments which we see is in transfer pricing issues, specifically disputes arising around countries like Italy and Germany, where these countries just change the arm's length price by replacing it by a much higher price, and then in the end they demand from you to, if you do want to have a compromise, which means that you actually pay more than you should be entitled to, provided that your documentation is correct, that you pay more because you have to compromise. And if you want to compromise, you have to sign that you don't want to go in a mutual agreement procedure, which is currently a situation which for many companies leads to the conclusion to just pay and make sure that you get rid of the discussion. Against Italy, it's known that there is an infringement procedure being started by the European Commission against this practice. So they did see, they have been informed by the tax advisors like myself, that this issue is currently doing harm to international businesses, and so diving into this at the moment. Against Germany, this is more or less a recent development. Germany was always one of the states with a very structured way, tax administration dealing with things, but more and more things are getting much more complicated. In a couple of, I think it's in the, one of the webcasts before the end of this year, my colleague Hans Mooy will discuss about mutual agreement procedures, and he will explain also some issues regarding Germany in that perspective. Further on, it is a difficult world to do tax litigation or to make sure that you finish any tax audit with the lowest possible burden for you, when you know that in some states within the European Union, even tax inspectors get a bonus depending on the achievement results of any tax audit being currently performed by the tax inspector. And in these kind of situations, it's probably inevitable that many companies will arrive in a situation where you just have to go to the court, since at this moment, no other ways are possible to deal with any controversy issues. Arbitration will probably be a solution for the future. It's still difficult this moment. So I more or less have selected three cases where I was involved with, which doesn't say actually that I'm running these cases. One of them I actually rejected simply because I didn't believe in the case. And the other two cases I'm involved in a certain matter. And these three cases all deal with family-based offices working across the globe, having a much less clear distinction of functions simply because these are smaller companies and the substantial shareholder is often the person dealing with the world and traveling around, and that makes it all a little bit more complicated than, for example, for multinationals. But in order to build the house about litigation, let's first dive into some building bricks. And these are just a few of the things you have to take into account, because in any case, any tax administration will also take them into account. And as said, to my notice, many cases from the past are being discussed based on criteria from the future. Keep that into account. Keep it in mind that that's, of course, not the way we have to go forward. It's clear that you cannot apply new rules, specifically when they have principally changed the playing field of the past, and apply these new rules on situations of the past. But still, a few things you have to take into account. And first of all, controlled foreign cooperation rules. It's a very open action of OECD where they actually made a collection of all the CFC rules being applied by any state in the world, and putting them in one action and providing them as a suggestion to the states of the world to just pick and choose whenever rule they want to apply. And that's actually what you see happening. It was not too long ago, I think 2-3 weeks ago, when the Australian Tax Organization said to the world that the acting in concert test, which is a specific CFC rule from the US, where companies not having control over a third company, or corporations not having control over a third corporation, but acts in concert, are actually being deemed to be in control. And ATO has just recently announced that they will apply this acting in concert rule also for their new transfer pricing issue. So CFC rules are getting much more important within the European Union, also very important for the family businesses. For me, it always has been strange that CFC rules are currently part of the and the tax avoidance directive, since CFC rules are only necessary for tax credit systems and not tax exemption systems. However, probably because it's not fully clear to what extent you should apply CFC rules, and my perspective might be a little bit more, much too technical, we now have to cope with this. But apparently, whenever you have a decent anti-avoidance rules in place, like Dutch government, the Dutch code has, we have very specific, not just controlled foreign, but also controlled domestic cooperation legislation in place, which actually gives a specific collection of rules, actually filling already in the demand of the ATAD. Very important, ladies and gentlemen, for all cases you might ever have, or for all situations you have to judge on, whether you're an inspector, an advisor, or a tax director of a company, are of course the principal purpose test in combination with limitation on benefits. The principal purpose test is a difficult situation to understand. If you would read Action 6 of OECD, then you will actually notice that they state that the principal purpose test is a test actually saying that if one of the principal purposes for having, for example, a corporation, an intermediary holding company in an intermediary holding country is taxation, one of the principal purposes is taxation, from that moment on, the payer country could, for example, deny the lowering of withholding taxes, or even deny the interest payment to that corporation. And the problem is the word principal purpose test. If you look at the new commentary as being described by Action 6, you will see that they give an example which is more or less the following. Suppose that the US multinational has a few subsidiaries in the European Union and they want to centralize services by creating an intermediary somewhere in the European Union. And the question then is, in which country should you locate that intermediary company? Then they give all kinds of arguments which are probably a decisive argument for the choice of allocation. One of them is, for example, infrastructure, stable political system, people speaking the language, education, whatever more. And then they say, if after having selected all these criteria, you have chosen, for example, for an intermediary in the Netherlands, then that is fine. But, that's the last sentence, tax reasons also play a role. And tax reasons will always play a role in any structuring, simply because no company will just structure a company without taking into account these tax rules. If you would read the MLI, and then the, not the MLI as such, but the instructions with the MLI by OECD, you will read that at a certain stage, they discuss principal purpose, but they then write also sometimes called primary purpose test. And to my opinion, there is a very principal difference between principal purpose and primary purpose. So I assume that it's meant by OECD to just make clear that it is being used as a primary purpose test, but they still believe it should be interpreted as the principal purpose test. But it's a little bit confusing because primary purpose test, then you really have to weigh whether criteria is more decisive, like economic or infrastructure or political stability or whatever. And in that situation, it could be that criteria like infrastructure and stability are much more decisive than tax, and then that situation would therefore be acceptable. The principal purpose test, it can also be found in the parent subsidiary directive of the European Union, and is as such probably soon to be discussed for the courts of this world, simply because as it's currently being applied by countries like Italy, Portugal and Spain, it appears that they use the principal purpose test to deny any deduction or to deny any lowering of a withholding tax if, for example, the intermediary is in the Netherlands, Belgium, Luxembourg or Ireland, simply because they suggest that taxation is also one of the reasons why that countries have been chosen. And a current decision of the European Court of Justice, the ENCA case, under the previous parent subsidiary directive, the ECJ rejected more or less a reasoning like that you have to prove that tax is also one of the principal purposes or not one of the principal purposes in order to be accepted. I assume, it's not for today, but I assume that based on cases like Cadbury Chess and Kent Centos of the European Court of Justice, that the current principal purpose test under the directive will also be in discussion and will probably be cancelled by the European Court of Justice. Another issue for litigation, another issue for controversy, is of course the discussion about permanent establishments. You all know that the main changes in permanent establishments are in 5.4, 5.5, 5.6. So auxiliary preparatory activities is one of the issues. The commission agent agreement is also one of these issues. And the independent agent, as the last one, is also one of the issues. Well, not going to discuss this today. We will probably do a specific webcast in the future on these issues and on the disputes which can arise here. the reason for it is that we also have to wait a little bit on the states and what kind of positions they will take under the MLI. Give you just one example. Switzerland recently published that under the MLI they will only select 10 treaties of the 95 or whatever, which will be cover tax agreements, which means that they actually hardly apply the new rules on any tax conventions which are important to them, and in that situation the old rules will still be applicable. Action 8 to 10 is about allocation of risk intangibles in line with significant people functions, and that's actually the major one which I'm going to address in the cases we are going to discuss. First of all, the procurement company case. We have here a household equipment BV which makes all kinds of things for kitchens and are being sold all about around the European Union. And suppose in a very simple way that this corporation buys the goods at a low price of $1 in China. And suppose that normally the price in the sales price, for example, the Netherlands would be $10, then it's clear that $9 should be taxed. The company has created a procurement company in Singapore. Singapore has an offshore regime, which means that whenever you operate from Singapore, that all the revenues you receive are only taxable there when you have onshore activities. And in this situation, there is a procurement company registered in Singapore, which formally procures all the materials from China, sells them on to the Netherlands. And as a consequence, you'll see that a margin is being allocated to Singapore of, in this situation, €6.50, and that margin is actually tax exempt. So from a tax perspective, a margin previously of $9 to be taxed at 25% in the Netherlands is now being converted in $6.50 being tax exempt and only $2.50 being taxed in the Netherlands, which means that this is really a tax optimization structure. The problem, however, is twofold. First of all, if in Singapore nothing is happening, if actually the people doing the procurement are people based in the Netherlands, but they act on behalf of a Singapore procurement company, which is just registered there and administered from Singapore, the first question any tax inspector will raise is, what is the seat of the company? Is it a Singapore corporation or is it a Dutch corporation? And in a situation where not too many things are happening, it might be a difficult discussion, and probably you might win it on the seat of the corporation. But the second question is also, what is actually happening there? And I'm now not applying actions 8 to 10, but I just want to inform you what the future is going to be, and that will give you a view on what currently the tax inspectors will deal with whenever they have such a case. The future of procurement companies is simple. OECD has written down in Action 8 to 10, and it is already in the new transfer pricing guidelines, that when I have a procurement company buying for the whole group, then in principle, procurement is a service, is a function, which is not always adding principal value, which should principally be taxed in the country where the company is a resident. Actually, they buy and they make the benefit because they buy for the full company, for all the corporations within the company, and therefore they will use economies of scale. And according to OECD, in most situations, a cost-plus situation would be a sufficient reward for the activities of the procurement company. So that would mean that if the cost in Singapore would be X, let us assume 6% would be a reasonable allocation of profit to Singapore, and the remaining 94% should be divided about the parties which actually procure, which actually use these benefits from the procurement company. In this specific case, which, as I said, I haven't accepted, for me, substance issues were a main issue. Real activities was a main issue. And I just didn't felt comfortable enough to continue in this case. This is actually a situation of old-fashioned tax planning, as which has happened for years, the last couple of decades, where it was quite easy to register a company and to create all kinds of benefits. But in the current stage of affairs, even with a case as this one, which is actually from the last couple of years, I still believe that the substance issues, substance is always dynamic definition of something, but of a status, but still, when nothing is really happening in a corporation, it's going to be quite difficult to defend this one. The next one is a totally different situation. This is a situation of a company making pumps. Pumps are used in all kinds of industries. Factories, smaller factories, water companies, but also mining companies. So in all our industries, you will find small, but also very big pumps. And some of them have to be functioning in freezing kind of situations. Sometimes pumps have to be functioning in hot situations. So it's a demanding business, and these tailor-made pumps are being made in this company. And at a certain stage, this company was asked whether they could provide a solution for a pumping system for a specific mine in Latin America. And in that situation, they were not able to produce it yet. However, they have been looking around the globe, and they found people in Canada, America, in Australia, and in Latin America, which had a lot of experience with building such a pump. So they were able to build a design team of these people flying in this situation to Hong Kong. And from Hong Kong, they designed this pump. They registered this pump, and they actually were able to create a joint venture with a Chinese company which could build this pump according to the conditions as being designed by this team. In this specific situation, we're also discussing a substantial shareholder company with not too many people around the world directly, but a joint venture in China producing this one. And this pump is only being developed for outside the European Union. It's actually only being sold to Latin America and a little bit in Australia. In this situation, the dispute is all about whether, again, the seat of the corporation is in the Netherlands, which is, to my opinion, a clear situation of not being in the Netherlands simply because the design and even also the risk aspects of the foreign analysis, the functions as Swiss aspects, were actually being covered from Hong Kong, and Hong Kong was able to cover these also. But the most important reason is the gateway to China was, of course, Hong Kong. Hong Kong was therefore the location because China was the country where the joint venture, where the pumps are being made. And the people designing the pump, also the people involved in any warranty or liability claim, were the people from all around the world flying into Hong Kong, and from that location dealt with this. In this situation, which is still running case, the tax administration wants the full profit to be taxed in the Netherlands, which is a little bit strange from the perspective that, as said, the pumps are not being sold here. The design development warranty liability is being done from outside the European Union. That makes it quite difficult. Discussions here could, of course, be the seat of the company. Sometimes permit establishment issues could arise, simply depending on where these activities take place and to what extent they deal with, for example, the Chinese operations, but also actions they took that are new transfer pricing guidelines. To my notice, there are many cases in my country where Hong Kong is a situation being used for real activities, being the gateway to China, playing a role in development, playing a role in some other activities. But also, I have to say that I also came across more situations where actually Hong Kong was just an old-fashioned structure to actually create a base erosion, or if you may call it that way, a profit-shifting situation, profit-shifting away from, for example, the Netherlands. The last case I want to discuss with you is a recent one where we can see how complicated these BEPS actions are actually taking place. This is a company trying to create a dental whitening product so you can whiten your teeth in a very natural way, in a very effective way, and not using the current products in the market. And so they have tried to develop these in the Netherlands. And they even used a Dutch research institution called TNO to help them developing this. And they worked for years on this product, and it was not possible to get a satisfying end product. So in the end, they across the world, and they found in Taiwan a company which believed that they could produce it. They had a specific procedure in place, and after a couple of years, 3.5 years of research, they were able to produce it. And from that moment on, this product is being produced in Taiwan. They had for the organization, because this product is also being sold around the globe, that's the intention of the company, they of course they created a Hong Kong company again. And the discussion is again here that since at this moment the majority of the sales are in the Netherlands, the Dutch tax inspector says, well, this is interesting, but since the market is in the Netherlands, we believe that 100% of the profits should be allocated to the Netherlands. And here you get this strange situation that the company says, actually, we agree, it's fine with us that you allocate all the profit to the Netherlands, but then we want to have the patent box being applied. And here you get the relation with Action 5. Since after Action 5 and the ATA directive, the patent box is not applicable anymore since this product is being made in Taiwan. So on the one hand, they say, the company says, we are fine with this product, the benefits of this product being taxed in the Netherlands, but then we want to have the patent box. And the Dutch tax administration says no, because you cannot fulfill the nexus condition. Or we want to have a taxed, at least to a certain extent, let us assume 50%, we want to have a taxed allocated to Hong Kong, because then we have the benefit of taking into account the real facts that this is being developed in that region, and this is also being sold in that region and in the future. But one of the two should be fine. And actually, yeah, the discussion is now about the tax administration saying, no, everything is taxed in the Netherlands, however, you cannot use the patent box. And this is like a very, very difficult situation. since you achieve a situation which you cannot solve, and the company is willing to work in a solution, but apparently it's not difficult, not easy to do so. So these three offshore cases are three totally principle different cases. The first one, to my opinion, is a case which is which is going to be lost for the company. The last one is a case where the company says, okay, we want to agree with you, let's tax in the Netherlands, but then at least you'll get a patent box and new rules makes it impossible. So a company with a very sympathetic behavior attitude against tax administration, more or less being punished by new rules, and probably these rules are not really fit to solve all kinds of issues like these ones. And the second one of the cases is a case where some things are being produced the other side of the world and actually fail to get the treatment it should actually deserve to get. We are now, at the moment, we are 50 minutes in this webinar, and I now think it's time for the last 10 minutes for you to censor us. If necessary, I can discuss some other issues, but I think make sure that you can raise your questions. Please raise your questions now, and I can answer them. If you believe or you feel more free to raise the questions by email, of course, this is also possible. But first of all, if you want to raise your questions now, please raise them. If not, then I would like to use the last minutes of this call to discuss a few new developments. First of all, permanent establishment issues. You might have read in the papers that there is a lot of things going on with digital economy. You might have read that the European Union is wanting to introduce an equalization levy, which is actually a corporate income tax levy besides the current systems or based under the current systems, however, which actually infringe the current tax conventions. You might have read in the paper that OECD is also suggesting this, but just as an intermediary solution in order to give some time to all parties to develop a decent solution under Article 5 of the OECD and the United Nations Model Tax Conventions. But recently it was known that, as you probably know, companies like Amazon are based in Ireland, and from Ireland they actually create the benefits all around the European Union, so also in Austria. And recently it was known that Austria has said to Ireland, we are going to terminate the convention with Ireland simply because we don't believe Ireland is going to approve any recommendation of the European Commission to get into a new harmonization proposal and to make sure that we do not wait too long and receive the benefits we should receive from the Amazon sales, for example, in Austria. We cancel the tax convention. So also from a tax policy perspective, the world is in a dynamic phase currently, and it's we have to wait and see what's going to happen. To my opinion, there is only one reasonable solution, and that is actually based on the experience in the United Nations Model Tax Convention, Article 5, 6, insurance companies. Is actually also in the treaty. I've learned, by the way, yesterday, I didn't know that from a client, that it's also in the convention with the Dutch Kingdom. There's also a comparable provision on insurance companies. What it does say that if an insurance company from state A sells or insures risks in state B, that as such creates a permanent establishment in state B, so without having a fixed place. So the solution should be found in Action 5. I understand that the allocation mechanisms are going to be quite difficult, but still it's probably the only way forward. In the meanwhile, are there any questions with you, Esat? If not, I'm going to address a few last issues regarding the MLI. If questions, I'm of course very willing to answer them. If not, some last remarks on the MLI. The BEPS plans were very ambitious. 1.5 years ago, in the midst, I spoke to Pascal Centerman at an OECD meeting in Istanbul, and I asked him how he was doing, and he was actually responding like, Hans, your real question is, what you want to know is whether I think it's going to be a success, and he says, it's probably not going to work out 100% perfectly well, but it's going to end somewhere in the middle. And that's indeed the achievement. BEPS is here to stay, that's clear. However, the implementation of all the BEPS actions, under, based on the MLI, as already discussed about Switzerland, is going to be quite difficult because we don't know the positions of many states. We do know that, for example, my country, the Netherlands, that we didn't take any reservations yet. We can still take them. We know that Switzerland actually wants to continue more or less the old way by just selecting 10 conventions to be covered tax agreements, as they call it, under the MLI, which means that all the other conventions with most European Union states, but many other states around the globe, will not be covered by the MLI. We know that Germany, for example, has made reservation under Article 5.4, which is property and auxiliary activities, simply because they say if we would agree that they have 10,000 of cars, of all the BMW, Mercedes on locations in China being sold over there, that would create a permanent establishment and therefore a relocation, or let me rephrase myself, it would lead to a shifting of taxable profit from Germany to China. Just that's what they don't want to happen. Luxembourg made a long list of reservations, and Ireland the same. So apparently the MLI, which should be the ultimate way forward for BEPS, seems to be a little bit disappointing, and that's not the only one. I more or less addressed in a few words, and as said, it will be in a later webinar from TPA. Hans Mooy, who is here present at this webcast, will present later on his experiences with the MEP, but in a yesterday published report of OECD about mutual agreement procedures, where they actually have looked into the best practices of the best states in the world, the conclusions were quite disappointing. And we will address this asset in a later webinar, and also explain that probably the only way forward in those kind of situations would be arbitration. But that's for later. I would like to thank you all for participating in this webinar. I hope that you will be joining us again next month. And as said, if there are any questions, just post me an email. You can find my email address also on my website. So be free to send me an email. And again, hoping that you will join us again in a month's time. Thank you very much.